Bye, Fern. Good morning, Calvary Chapel.
Good morning.
How are y'all doing?
Happy Father's Day.
That's right. We got notes and everything. Let's pray, guys. Father, we just come to you, Lord, and we're thankful for just the place that you've given us to gather, Lord, the people that, Father, you've blessed us with. And Lord, we just would ask for the fellowship to be rich and Lord, the study of your word and, Father, just communion and prayer and these four would, Lord, just be in abundance, Lord, as, Father, we seek your face. And we just look to you as the author and the finisher of our faith. How good it is, Lord, when the fellowship is rich and, Lord, when the saints gather together to just glorify you. We pray, God, that you would just be in the very center of our praise and you would inhabit the praises of your people, Lord. And, Father, we ask, God, that you would just instruct us and just remind us, Lord, by your Holy Spirit. We love you so much, and we just pray for all those that are sick, that are suffering with different things, Lord. And we just ask, God, that you would touch and heal. For Jim, Lord, and his shoulder, for Jim and his ports and all the things that are going on with him, Lord. And so many others, we just ask, God, for your favor upon them, Lord, and that, Lord, you would just do a work in them, Father. And we just thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your love. That I would be saved. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
You are peace when my fear is crippling. You
are true, you are true. Even in my wandering, you are joy, you are joy. You're the reason that I sing. You are light, you are light. In you death has lost its sting. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever is. You are more, you are more. You are Lord, you are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And I'm running to your arms. Your arms, the riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reigns. My heart will sing, no other name. Sing no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reigns. I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reigns.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and cannot trust the sweetest thing, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ the Lord, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I'll rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ the
hands and multiply. God, all that I am, and find my heart. On the altar again, set me on fire, set me on fire. Take all I have in these hands and multiply. God, all that I am, and find my heart. On altar again, set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken. My heart of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me, you will be with me. Here I am, Lord, arms wide open, pouring out my life. Jesus now, all all to Jesus now. Holding nothing back, holding nothing back, I surrender, I surrender, I surrender.
Praise you, Lord, as long as we have breath, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you so much for your goodness to us. We thank you for all the love you pour out on us day by day the forgiveness that you wrap around us, God, the wisdom that you give us through the power of your Holy Spirit, the comfort and the guidance. We praise you and thank you for your word. We worship you for who you are, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our majesty. We bow our hearts before you because you are worthy of all our praise. And at your name, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of the Father. We praise you and thank you, Jesus, that you have accepted us in the Beloved, that we are your family, God. And we long to see this love of yours shine throughout our nation, Lord, that you would take it to the ends of the earth. And Father, we thank you for being our Father, our perfect Father. And thank you for giving us fathers, Lord, whether they were really great fathers or fathers that really tried or maybe didn't try so hard. Lord God, we thank you for this way that you've given us to help us to see the Heavenly Father, whether it's through a good example or a bad example, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you are the best and that we can always trust in you. And we lift up our fathers to you, all the fathers. And we ask, God, for your blessing and anointing on them. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen.
Love one another.
Oh, just 28. Wow, Britt's right. I am late. It got quiet before I even got up here. You guys are done fellowshipping?
No.
Okay, good. Happy Father's Day, everyone. Well, all the dads. Like you and you and you and you and you. You, 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 you.
So many
fathers. Me. Oh, Bob. Yeah, the other Bob. All right, so we're going to be in Psalm 110 today, and this is the announcement of the Messiah's reign. I'm going to read the odd number of verses. You can read the even. It's just seven verses, so we'll get through it real quick. This is a great one. So let's stand for this. I'll even stand. Stand off to the side. There's a chair here. Yeah. Nope. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies a footstool.
The Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of Zion, rule the midst of your enemies.
Your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power, in the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning. You have the dew of your youth. The Lord is at your right hand. He shall execute kings in the day of his wrath.
He shall judge among the nations. He shall fill the places with dead bodies. He shall execute the heads of many countries.
He shall drink of the brook by the wayside. Therefore he shall lift up his head. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you that you do rule and reign. I know sometimes when we look at this world, we think that you're not in control, but you are. You're just being patient. Lord, thank you for delaying the day of your wrath long enough for us to come to know you. Lord, help us to share your love and forgiveness and salvation, Lord, the good news with others before your day does come. And then they no longer have that choice. Lord, we thank you that you are so good to us and set us such an example of fatherhood. That self-sacrificing, the correction, the encouragement, exhortation, instruction. Lord, thank you for the fathers we've had. And Lord, thank you for the men who are still raising kids, Lord. Just give them that strength and wisdom whether their kids are 10 or their kids are 20 or 30 or 40, Lord. We need your wisdom and strength. In Jesus' name.
Father's got your little lights. And let your light shine for the glory of God. Amen. Dads, why don't you go ahead and stand up and let's pray for you. Father, we just come before you, Lord, and we want to lift up these dads. And we want to, first of all, thank you, Lord, that you blessed us with men who are fathers, who take the responsibility and not lightly, but take it as it should be taken, seriously. And just the heaviness of the responsibility. And Lord, just that we would be just a glory to you. And Father, we would ask, God, that you would just strengthen these men to the task that, Lord, you have called them. That, Lord, you would bless them, show your favor upon them. And Lord, may they be dependent upon your Holy Spirit, Lord, just to receive instruction, to receive remembrance concerning the things that they are to be about. Bless them, Lord, and fill them with your Holy Spirit. And Lord, just use them in a mighty way with the kids, whether they be below 5 or whether they be up in the 30s or 40s, Lord. May they just really be strengthened and given wisdom upon wisdom, Lord, to just speak out, to be men of prayer, prayer warriors who pray for their boys, their girls. And Lord, we just ask God for your favor upon them. In Jesus' most precious name, and everybody said. Okay, now we want to stand for Israel. Sorry, you guys. See if you guys are picking up on it. I'm not going to say a word. Amen. You may be seated. I think that's all I had. Happy Father's Day, though, guys. Have a blessed day. Amen. We're in John chapter 14, verse 25 and 26 this morning, speaking concerning these same things, that the Lord would do a work within each one of us that would be a work of instruction and be a work of remembrance, that the Holy Spirit would be that paracletes, that helper that would come and comfort, but be alongside of us no matter what it is that we're going through at the particular time. And so beginning in verse 25, we're going to look at just two verses this morning. It says, "These things I have spoken to you while being present with you." So while I'm with you, these are the things I spoke to you. But I'm not going to be with you so much longer. So verse 26 says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said unto you." So those two functions of the Spirit that are listed here, one that he would teach you all things and bring these things to remembrance. Now, just a caveat here for a second. The Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, don't let that confuse you. Of the modern English translations of the Bible, it's only the King James Version of the Bible which uses the term Holy Ghost, and it occurs 90 times in the King James Version. The term Holy Spirit occurs 7 times in the King James Version. There's no real clear reason as to why the words are translated ghost and spirit, but the translation of them, ghost and spirit, at different occurrences of this word, same meaning that is brought forth from it. With the recent scripture translations, spirit has replaced ghost in most instances. And some of this came about because the words don't really always hold to their meanings. But don't let that throw you, don't let that confuse you or frighten you. They can be used interchangeably, Spirit, Holy Spirit, and Holy Ghost. Like I said, a lot of it has to do with just the time in which it was being referred to as well. Regardless though of that, he's coming back to this promise. What promise? I will pray the Father, the Lord speaking, and he will give you another Paracletus. And so the Comforter, the one that comforts, the Holy Spirit, is going to come, and he's going to be, number one, our instructor. Isn't it great to be instructed by the author of a book? I mean, if you wrote a book, wouldn't it be great just to, you know, sit down with that person that wrote it and be able to be taught the things that are in it and are carried by it? Well, that's what he's referring to here at this point, that he is going to be our instructor. To me, it's such a blessing to have the Holy Spirit with the ability to open up my understanding to a passage of Scripture. As I'm preparing for you guys, I'll be looking at the text and the context and pretext and all, and trying to figure out, well, what in the world, Lord, are you talking about? And there's times that I get to that point, things that I've wrestled with, and I search them out in the Greek, and I try to really discover what the meaning is, because I want to be able to translate that to you guys. And so I'm sitting there thinking, what did he mean by that? And then suddenly the Holy Spirit just gives me like a dump load full of understanding and teaches us, teaches you. That's what Jesus said that the Comforter would do. In fact, what he refers to here is that you call him alongside of you. He's the one who is called alongside. And so you call for the help of the Holy Spirit, and he begins to unfold the truth of God in your heart. He begins to give and to bring that instruction, teaching us what we are to do in a certain situation, teaching us how we're to respond. But it's not just instruction, as we said. He will also bring your remembrance, or bring to you remembrance. And after Jesus rose from the dead, then the disciples remembered how he had said to them. And they remembered all these things after the Holy Spirit had come upon them. A lot of things that Jesus said really went over their heads. Whenever he would talk about his death, it just went right over their head. When he said he was going to rise again, it went right over his head. And when he died, they thought it was all over. They thought that was the very end. It was finished. And they were going to just go home and go back to their own lives. But yet, when he was on the road to Emmaus, the Emmaus road with the two disciples, the day that he rose from the dead, and you remember he said, "Oh, foolish and slow of heart to believe." He had told them that he was going to rise the third day, and yet they were speaking disparagingly. He said, "Why are you guys so sad? Why are you talking like you're talking? Why are you talking like you're on your way to a funeral? Are you a newcomer here?" they would say to him. Where have you been? Don't you know what's been going on? What are you thinking? What are you talking about?" And they were somewhat upset with him because they hadn't seen what was going on. They hadn't seen the latest broadcast, if you would. And there was a man named, they began to share with them, there was a man named Jesus of Nazareth. And he was just an amazing guy, and he was going around doing good. He was healing all manner of sickness. And we had hoped in him. We had a hope in him for the salvation of Israel. These two began to share with the Lord as they were walking along the road. And they said, we thought that he was the Messiah, but they crucified him. And this is the third day. Some of his women this morning got hysterical, and they thought that they had saw him or seen him. And they came and they said that he was alive, that they saw him. But you know how situations can get away from you. But then Jesus rebuked them at their doubting. And he said, oh, foolish and slow of heart, to believe all the things that the prophets have said, ought not the Messiah to have suffered and died? And he went on and expounded the scriptures to them. And their hearts began to burn as he opened up the scripture to them according to Luke chapter 24, verse 13 through 32. And so here you see the Holy Spirit then brought to the remembrance the things that he had said. And so they recorded them for us in the Gospels. And we have other quotations of Jesus in the book of Acts that aren't in the Gospels as the Holy Spirit again brought them to their remembrance, brought them to where they could remember what had been said. Now, we too, it's not just the disciples way back when, but we also have been given the comfort of the Holy Spirit. The word translated comforter is parakletos, and it refers to someone who is, as we said, called to one side. With his disciples, Jesus was limited in that he could only be in one place at one time. And so he couldn't be as the Holy Spirit would be along one side in different locations. And that's why Jesus said, it is expedient for me to go away that the Comforter might come. It is very important for me to be on my way. Otherwise, the Comforter will not be able to come and to help you out, according to John chapter 16 and in verse 7. The Comforter is the one who will heal your hurts, he'll still your storms, and he'll supply your needs according to his riches in heaven. But that's what the Spirit is doing for us, guys. Now, though sometimes comforting involves correction and conviction, the Spirit is not a buzzard who circles over us waiting for us to fail, that he might come and pick at us. Nor is he a screeching hawk who makes a lot of noise, striking fear in the hearts of everyone around him. Neither is he a hummingbird who flaps his wings incessantly, yet makes no progress practically. The Spirit, though, is, however, a dove. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. A dove that is known for his gentleness, for his beauty, purity. Truly, he is a comforter in reality. And so again, these things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I have said unto you. Right now, we're on the Thursday evening before Jesus is crucified at the event known as the Last Supper. Jesus is alone with his disciples in the upper room, answering questions and instructing the disciples. And there you see in that first verse, verse 25, these things I have spoken unto you while being present with you. The things that Jesus had said have obviously been while he's been with the disciples. The ways in which he instructed them, taught them, while the disciples were there. But he's not going to be around forever to be their teacher. Not going to be around to be face to face. It's going to be time to move on shortly, really shortly. But the Helper, verse 26, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is the other comforter that we saw back in John 14, verse 16, where it says, "And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever." Jesus, as we know, had been their teacher. Jesus had been their Comforter for the last 3 years. But the Holy Spirit will be their teacher for the rest of their lives, forever. The guys are going to have to get used to a new model of learning, a new way of learning. No longer will it be by walking and talking with Jesus face to face, talking with their master. But now it's going to be through the invisible and yet very real and very close person of the Holy Spirit. So the question is, what about us? You know, we hear people tell us you need to be filled with the Spirit of God. You need to ask the Spirit of God to come into you. And we've talked about three different ways: with us, in us, and upon us. We need that operation of the Holy Spirit within us in order for us to accomplish anything. Amen. It really is essential that we have an understanding of that new mode of learning. No longer face to face. It'll now be through the invisible, yet very real and very close person of the Holy Spirit. And so what about us? Will we learn to adapt to working in the Holy, with the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives? Will we be able to adjust and adapt to that instruction and remembrance? Has a little bit of an understanding to receiving a new power source. It's what the disciples were receiving, and those that named the name of Jesus as their Lord and Savior. But it deals with electrical power. And I think, you know, I was thinking about this, it's not until you have a major power outage that you find out how much you depend upon electricity, right? You remember not too long ago on Wednesday night, I don't know if it was it's one of the storms or whatnot, but we had a power outage in the sanctuary. And two people that were visiting for the first time didn't know what in the world was going on. We couldn't catch them because they just jumped up and they just ran out of the double doors there. And it does funny things to people. It really does. But you also are tested and you find out not only how you respond in a chaotic situation, but how much you depend and rely upon electricity. Think back to the last time that you lost your power. You know, again, here at church or in your home. I mean, was it a fun experience for you having the electricity off? Not if you don't have lights where you need them. Not if you don't. If you're not prepared, it's not as, you know, acceptable as it is if you are prepared. And, you know, you're probably thinking, man, wouldn't it be better if you had your own independent source of electricity? You see the similarities with the Holy Spirit. But what if that source of power was portable? What if you have in your house, and maybe some of you do, you have your own Tesla power board, and you know, you don't have to worry about a thing because that is always going to be there to depend upon. And let everybody know in the church if you have that, so we know where to go. If we know where to go on that night. But, you know, here it is, you know, this power problem, this power grid that we depend on probably way too heavily. But it used to be that if you had a computer, where'd you have it? It was on your desk, wasn't it? We weren't, you know, prior to the times of having powerful batteries that would keep it going, it was usually there anchored to the electrical outlet. And whenever you wanted to use it, you had to go to your desk and work. And you had to have electricity working, but no more. Today we have laptop computers that we can have run on batteries. And you can go do your work at your, you know, in the beach or at the beach. And, you know, if you have this, you're so inclined, if you have the desire to do that, You can even work when the power goes off. I can work on my message on my laptop, out on the patio, in the front porch, you know, running off of batteries. And really not even realize that the power, if it does, has gone off inside the house. It's simply amazing if you think about it in such a short period of time, the distance that we've gone regarding these things. But the power shutdown, you'll find, doesn't really affect you immediately anyways, because you have your own independent source of power. And that's the phrase I want you guys to remember this morning. You have your own independent source of power in the Holy Spirit. And it's so important for us to understand how that works and how that is applied to our walks and to our lives. Very important. And so, again, as Christians, we can develop a dependence on people. And that's not always bad. I mean, it's not so bad, because there's a sense when we need each other, right? You know, and you have need of prayer for physical ailments or for problems that are taking place within your sphere of influence, and you're just trying to make it through and get through, you know, all the deals that are taking place in your life. So not such a bad thing to have other believers around you, other Christians around you. And especially if you're a new believer, you know, if you have questions that you need answer to, you know, you can go to gotquestions.org. But other than that, you can come to another believer in the church. Jim knows a lot. The gyms know a lot. If I tell you to go to gym, you get 3 for 1. So it works out pretty good. But, you know, it's important to know where you can go. And the one thing that you can do and go is to the Holy Spirit. And that's the thing here. You know, you come to know the Lord and you're walking with the Lord and you've made some friends and you've established some relationships, and you have people that answer questions that you might have. They'll pray with you. They'll support you. They'll encourage you in the things of the Lord. But there's the flip side of that, where people can and do sometimes fail you. Just like the power can get turned off sometimes, so to speak, people can fail us in that way. Or we can get to the point where the only time we can act like Christians is when we're at church. You know, we're in here and, hey, this is school. Why? Because you're connected. Or when you're with other Christians. And maybe perhaps not so much when you're away from church or you're away from other believers. Well, I say that to say this. The disciples were now facing a time in their lives when they were going to be unplugged from their old power source, Jesus, and now would need to depend upon a new source of spiritual power, the Holy Spirit. And that's the crux of the message and the words that he gives us in verse 25 and 26 today. And let me just say that one more time. They were going to be unplugged from their old power source, Jesus. And they would now have to depend upon a new source of spiritual power. That's the Holy Spirit. Verse 26 says, whom the Father will send in my name. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring remembrance all things that I said to you. And again, we read last week in John 14, if you want to flip back a page or so. But in John 14, verse 16 and 17, he says, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. The Father would be sending the Holy Spirit upon the disciples in response to Jesus' prayer for them. And so the Holy Spirit would no longer be just with the disciples. He would soon be in them and upon them as well. And so we find that there's a need to know about the sending of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. After his resurrection, Jesus told the disciples to wait for the Holy Spirit. So in Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but yet ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence." And so the Holy Spirit wouldn't just, as we said, just be with and in the disciples. He would also come upon the disciples. And a relationship with the Holy Spirit in which the disciples would receive power from God, the dunamis power from God, to be able to do the work of God, to be able to do the things that God commanded us to do. He's going to enable us. He's going to give us the power to be able to do that. And so, a relationship of an upon relationship with the Holy Spirit in which the disciples would receive the power from God. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he talks about this. "But you shall receive power, dunamis, after that the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth." And so for testimony, we would be in that position to be able to have that power. And again, the power is not of you, it's from the Lord. And we, you know, again, it's not something that you're having to figure out what you're going to say, how you're going to say it, but you're going to be able to, again, have the things brought to your remembrance. Okay, so not only is the Spirit of God teaching you, instructing you, you got to keep that as an earmark in the back of the book. That it's not only the instruction that you're receiving, but it's also remembrance. Oh, man, I forgot that. Don't be a forgetful Sam. You know, and understand that he's going to bring those things to your remembrance. A lot of people say, well, what am I going to say? You know, I don't have anything to say. I can't get out there and you know, be a witness. I can't be a Billy Graham. And it's like, God's not asking you to be a Billy Graham. What he's asking you to do here at this point is to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit of God. And as a part of that Holy Spirit relationship, you're going to have and you're going to encounter and receive in you know the instruction of the writer, the Holy Spirit, and the remembrance. So all of a sudden it's okay, I remember that. I remember that, Lord. And so he's instructing him in these things. And whether it be Samaria or Judea or Jerusalem, whether it be the uttermost parts of the earth, God's going to give you the ability to share the gospel, to share the things of the Lord. And all you need to do is look at the transformation of these scared, cowardly, and I'm you know, not saying we're any much better, but these cowardly disciples, when the Holy Spirit came upon them, man, it just blew them off the register. These are men who just days before had run from Jesus, denying that they knew him. And they had been hiding from the authorities. They didn't want to have anything to do with it. And then you read in chapter 2, verses 1 through 13 of Acts, you see the coming finally of the Holy Spirit, coming of the one that Jesus said, hey, you guys, take a seat, wait here for the Spirit to come upon you. And you notice in verse 1 of chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. So there's several things that were taking place as they were sitting there. These tongues of fire came down and rested upon them. And one sat upon each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Again, with us, in us, upon us. Filled is the upon experience of the Holy Spirit. And they begin to, at that point, speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They didn't come up with this on themselves of their own. They didn't manufacture it or think of a new language. It's the Spirit that gave them utterance. And then verse 5 says, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men, from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speaking in their own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of our own language in which we were born, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and even parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans, Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. And so they were amazed and they were perplexed, saying to one another, what could this mean? And yet there's always the mockers. They're full of new wine, is what their summation was. But as Peter is responding to this, he gets up to preach, and he preaches an impromptu sermon about Jesus with a great response. Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts. So there was a movement. There was a work that God was doing through the Holy Spirit. Not directly, but indirectly, doing that work. And they were pricked in their hearts and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent. I love it, Peter. I got an idea. How about this? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so believe and repent, and you'll receive the Holy Spirit. Always? Not necessarily. We'll see in a moment. Verse 39, for the promise is unto you. There's a promise for you. What is it? And to your children as well, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words he did testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from the untoward generation. And then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day they were added unto them about 3,000 souls. So an incredible work of the Spirit of God, laying hands upon those that were dry, that needed salvation and needed a word from the Lord. All of this coming from the man who denied Jesus three times. Three times he had denied him. You know, what about scared little Peter? What happened? Well, the Holy Spirit happened. That's what the Holy Spirit does. That's what God wants to do in your life with the Holy Spirit. Because when the Holy Spirit fills you, there isn't room for any old crud. Just that ability to move and to walk and to work in the Spirit of God. Dwight L. Moody once demonstrated a principle like this. He said, tell me, to the audience he was speaking to. He says, how can I get the air out of this tumbler that I have in my hand? One man said, suck it out with a pump. But the evangelist replied, that would create a vacuum and shatter it. Finally, after a whole slew of suggestions, Moody picked up the pitcher and quietly filled the glass with water. And he said, there, all the air is now removed. And then he explained that the victory for the child of God doesn't come by working hard to eliminate sinful habits, but rather by allowing the Holy Spirit to take full possession. And that's kind of the thing that happens with us, guys. We can look at our lives and we can say, you know, I've got all this sin in my life and it's filling up the glass. How do I get that out? You pour the water in and it replaces it, guys. What is that a symbol of? That's really the victory that is ours in Christ. Not by working hard to eliminate sinful habits, not by going into each one of those sinful habits and trying to deal with them one by one and one by one, but rather by allowing the Holy Spirit to take full possession of your life. Eliminating, therefore, all the crud and all the garbage that still remains within. Allow the Spirit of God to take full possession of your life. Are you looking for that victory? I hope you are. But if you are, let the Holy Spirit fill you. Because as the Holy Spirit fills you, that garbage and that gunk is all taken care of. Notice how Peter offers this huge crowd the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's nothing to be hoarded. It's not just for special limited people or initiated people. It's for everyone who will believe. That's who it's for. And then we see the power of God continuing to be demonstrated through the people. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. You might remember this. When you accepted the Lord, the person that led you in that prayer most likely shared these things with you, these four things that you were to continue to do. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' what? Doctrine. You all know. You know what he wants us to do. And so the first thing you do when you accept the Lord, you want to continue in the Word of God. You want to saturate yourself with the Word of God, the things of God given in the Word, the things that the Holy Spirit can give you through the Word. Again, instructing you and giving you remembrance. Oh, I can't remember the Scripture. You don't have to remember the Scripture. The Holy Spirit does it for you. And as you yield to the Spirit of God and you yield to the pouring of His Holy Spirit into your life to the point of overflowing. And as you do that, then God's able to work and bring those things to remembrance that you need to know, that you want to share, that you want to give to those people that are around you. And so we see the power of God continuing to be demonstrated through the people. Number one, in the apostles' doctrine, and in number two, is fellowship, right? And so you need to, as a new believer, be into the Word of God on a continual basis, just soaking it in, taking it up. Number two, you need to be in fellowship. Why? Because of what we just talked about, not 5 minutes ago, when we were talking about you have those friends that are believers. You have the church that you can go to. That's all fine and dandy. And it's a good place. It's a good soil for growth, to cultivate your growth in the Lord Jesus Christ. Excellent soil. But you need to have that fellowship. And then number three, the breaking of the bread. What's the breaking of the bread? Communion. So we find ourselves taking communion together as a body of believers. And there's power in that as well. The power that God is working in us and through us in the bread, in the blood of Christ, the communion that we celebrate. And then number four, the last one, is prayers. Those are the four things he says, I want you to do. There's a lot of other things. I mean, obviously we know we need to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love our neighbors as ourselves. We know that's a given. But the things as far as growth that he talks about is get into the Word of God and continue in that a doctrine. And then number two, fellowship. Continue in the fellowship, in the breaking of the bread, and in prayers. And then verse 44, in chapter 2 of Acts, it says, well, verse 43, it says that fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together, and they had all things in common. And they sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, daily they were going to church and breaking bread from house to house. So not only going to the church, but going to the neighbor's house and breaking bread together. And doing this, he said, they did eat their meat with gladness and a singleness of heart. These things brought about a gladness. Gladness in a world that is so sad and so depressed and so discouraged and so down. Even to the degree of believers experiencing and struggling with those same kinds of stresses in their life. And he says, according to that, it was parted to every man his need, but there was that gladness and not only that, a singleness of heart. They believed the same thing. They weren't just a replicate, but they believed in the same thing, in that singleness of heart, singleness of whose heart? Singleness of God's heart. And then he says it right there, verse 47, praising God and having favor with all the people, the Lord added to the church daily as should be saved. This is what happens when the Holy Spirit is allowed to get a hold of people's lives. And really, that's what the whole message is about this morning. Verse 25 and 26, you might have thought, well, two verses, what can you get from two verses? Actually, you can get quite a bit. You can get quite a bit from two verses, guys. And so this kind of stuff, the rejoicing, the gladness, the singleness of heart, the praising of God, having favor, this the work that God's doing in a miraculous way, not just miracles, but in a miraculous way, changing you 180 or 160, 150, no, 180. You're going this direction, you're turning 180 degrees, and you're coming back this way. Don't tell anybody I was an engineer major, so... I get so excited about the things of God and how He works in our lives, though, that it's just an amazing thing what God wants to do. And so I kind of just want to leave you this morning with seven questions about the Holy Spirit and give you a little bit of instruction here. Number one question, do you have to be baptized in water to receive the Holy Spirit? Anybody else? No. I mean, you might say, well, wait a minute, didn't Peter say repent and be baptized? No. Peter was led by the Lord to go to a pagan pig dog heathen Gentile's house. Did you guys get that? A pagan pig dog heathen Gentile house by the name of Cornelius. He began to give Cornelius, his family, and Cornelius a Bible study when he was rudely interrupted. How does he interrupt it? Do you guys remember? Acts chapter 10, it was where it took place, but the people were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Could you imagine being up here teaching and, you know, God's not the author of confusion and knowing that He's not going to have you do something that is opposite and direct from someone else? Well, here, Peter's trying hard to teach and to give a salvation message when all of a sudden they start getting baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 10, verse 47, it says, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? So they were kind of doing things backwards. They were receiving the upon experience or the filling experience of the Holy Spirit. And then after that, after they were filled, they were baptized in water in that believing of Jesus Christ. Number two, is baptism of the Holy Spirit different from being filled with the Holy Spirit? Huh? No. They're the same thing. Jesus calls it the baptism in Acts chapter 5, I mean chapter 1, verse 5. But when it comes to the disciples being filled, so it's got the baptism, you've got filled. It's also, just to give you an idea, called the promise in Acts 1, 4 and 2:33. It's called a gift in Acts 11, verse 17. Receiving the Holy Spirit in Acts 10, 47 and 19, 2. And the Holy Spirit falling upon people in Acts chapter 11, verse 15. And so, is it different from being filled with the Holy Spirit? Filled, baptized, same thing. Okay? Number three, is this a one-time experience or does it happen over and over again? Baptism of the Holy Spirit, the filling of the Spirit. Over and over again, yeah. The disciples were filled many times. Not just in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4, verse 8. It tells us there that in 4:8 that Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said unto them, "You rulers of the people and the elders of Israel." And then again in Acts 4:31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. And then again, Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, "And be ye not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be ye what? Be ye being filled with," just added that being. Why? Because it's a past, present participle, something like that. But what it basically means is it says that be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, and be ye being filled. In other words, continually filled of the Spirit of God. Number four, can a person believe in Jesus and not be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Think hard. Yeah, because what about the two thieves on the cross next to Jesus? Not able to get down and get baptized, were they? So can a person believe in Jesus and not be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Yes, they can. Now, some people do teach that the baptism of the Holy Spirit occurs when a person believes in the Lord, so that all who believe have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Philip was in the middle of a revival in Samaria, and many people were coming to believe in Jesus and to be baptized by Philip. In Acts chapter 8 and in verse 12 it says, "But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women." But apparently, though the people believed and were baptized, they had not received the power of the Holy Spirit. And so back to Acts chapter 8, verse 14, it says, "Now, when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they were come down prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them." So the Spirit of God had not fallen on any of them. "Only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." So water baptism. "And then laid their hands upon them, and they received the Holy Spirit." Paul also found a group of people that believed, yet without the power of the Holy Spirit. And Paul did that in Acts chapter 19, verses 1 and 2. "And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples, he said to them, 'Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed?' And they said to him, 'We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit.'" So they responded by saying, "What are you talking about?" Basically, "We don't know what you're talking about." And then in Acts chapter 19, verse 6, it said, "When Paul had laid hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke with tongues and they prophesied." So that brings into question number five. What do you think question number five is? Do you have to speak in tongues to receive the power of the Holy Spirit? No. It does not occur, at least clearly so, in every occurrence in the book of Acts. Acts 4:31, "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness." The revival in Samaria and subsequent visit of the apostles lacking any mentioning of tongues in Acts chapter 8. And then again, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27 and verse 30, "Now you are the body of Christ, the members in particular, and God has set some of the church in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that, miracles, then the gifts of the healings, helps, governments, diversity of tongues." And all of the apostles, he asked the question, "Are all apostles and are all prophets, are all teachers, all are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of the healing? Do they all speak with tongues? Do they all interpret? The way he's written this is, you know, rhetorical in the sense that the expected answer or the demanded answer at this juncture is no. Some have said the reason that it's no is because the Corinthians were such a carnal church. But that's not Paul's point here. They don't all speak with tongues because there's supposed to be diversity in the church and we're all supposed to have different gifts, different ministries and different results. If we were all the same, then there would be no diversity. So that doesn't work. Number 6, what is the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Acts chapter 1, verse 8, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and to all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And again, that word power there again in chapter 1, verse 8, is dunamos. We've all heard it referred to and have the base word of dynamite. But it's the power of God. And that's kind of okay. Its root idea, though, is strength, power, and ability. That God is going to not command you what he won't enable you to do. God does that in our lives. And so it comes from the word dunamai, which means to be able, to have power, to be able to do something, to be capable, strong, and powerful. Before the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Peter was running scared and denying the Lord. Afterwards, he had the ability to stand up in front of a huge crowd and preach, leading 3,000 people we knew to the Lord. And then he enters in this idea of fruit. We believe that the overall evidence that a person has been filled with the Holy Spirit is the fruit of the Spirit. Are you with me? What's the evidence of a person being filled with the Spirit of God? The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is what naturally develops in a person's life when they begin to continually walk in the power and the fullness of the Holy Spirit. It's the kind of things that the Holy Spirit gives you power or ability to do. And the singular fruit has 9 different qualities, if you look at it. You can find it in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. And it's like, when you look at it, a lot of people have said that the fruit of the Spirit is da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and they rattle off these 10 things. The fruit of the Spirit is love, further described by and elaborated upon these different qualities. So the fruit of the Spirit is love, stop, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against these things, there is no law. And so when you're truly filled with the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit will begin to produce each of these 9 qualities in your life. And you'll be a more joyful person. You'll be a more peaceful person, long-suffering. You'll develop patience and gentleness. And on down through the whole thing. Those will be cultivated within you. Those will be developed within you. Amen? Are you still there? Number 7, how do I get it? How do I get the Spirit? You ask. I believe one of the clearest answers to this is found in John chapter 7, verse 37. 38 and 39. John 7, 37 through 39. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried and said, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified." Could summarize it with really 3 steps. How do you get the Holy Spirit? Thirst. That's the first thing he says. If any man thirst, you need to realize that you have a need for the power of the Holy Spirit. You have a need for this. You're not just listening to this and just going, "Well, that's nice. I'm glad you have that." No, you need this. You need the power of the Holy Spirit within your life. Amen? Amen? Oh, that's getting nice. So if any man thirsts, you need to realize you have a need for it, a need for the power of the Holy Spirit. And if you're not needy and thirsty, then you're not going to receive it. But if on the other hand you realize that you have a great need in your life for the Holy Spirit, then you're in the right place. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, "Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be what?" All right. Everybody say it. Filled. All right. What does that look like? Well, a city dweller moved to a farm, bought a cow. Shortly after he did, the cow went dry. When he reported this fact to a neighbor who was a farmer also, the farmer expressed surprise. The city man said he was surprised too. "I can't understand it at all. For if ever a person was considerate of an animal, it was that guy of his cow. He said, if I didn't need milk, I didn't milk her. And if I only needed a quart, I only took a quart." The farmer tried to explain to him that the only way to keep the milk flowing is not to take as little as possible from the cow, but to take as much as you can. That'll keep your cow flowing. Number two, ask. Jesus said, "Let him come unto me and drink." So again, if any man thirsts, ask and drink. He also said in Luke chapter 11, verse 11, "If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father," good Father's Day verse, "will he give him a stone? Or if he ask for a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he ask for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit that ask for them?" You need to ask, guys, for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Number three, believe. Jesus said, "He that believes on me." It's not a matter of feelings, it's about a matter of trust. And you may feel a rush and of warmth down your spine. You may feel nothing. But Jesus didn't ask you to feel. He asked you to believe. The rest isn't really crucial. Sometimes people had laid hands on them. Could happen, couldn't, or could not. But so it says at other times in Acts chapter 2, they didn't. So sometimes people had hands laid on them in Acts chapter 8. Sometimes they didn't. Sometimes people were in prayer when they received it, Acts 2 and 4. Sometimes they were just at a Bible study. So you can't really put it into a cubicle and say, this is how it has to happen. It doesn't work that way. And then he says, just believe. John wrote 1 John 5:14 and 15, "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will," is it his will that you guys be filled with the Spirit of God? Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, you need that, especially in today's world. You need the power of the Holy Spirit. And that comes just by the asking and believing that God is who he says he is. And if we know that he hears us whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire. Is it God's will for you to be filled in the Holy Spirit? Then ask. You'll receive it. Amen. Are you still there? Did you hear me, Jim? So good to hang out with you guys. No. All right, let's continue to worship the Lord then. What it will be like when I walk by your side, I can only imagine. What my eyes will see when your face before me, I can only imagine. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Na 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 na. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Na na na. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Na 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 na. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yo de de do. I can only imagine.
Heavenly Father, God, your majesty, we can only imagine being in your presence, having your spirit, having your face before us, Lord. And now, even in the meantime, we have your spirit living in us, guiding us into all truth, comforting us, showing us your ways, Lord, giving us your power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your sacrifice. And we pray that your name would be high and lifted up in us. Lord, we bless you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
God bless you guys, fathers. Blessings to you and upon you.